What's up, everybody? My name's Adam McDorman, and this is American Literature. This week, we're going to read a pretty short excerpt from a text called A Model of Christian Charity by John Winthrop. Now, as always, the best way for us to get the most out of this text is to know a little bit about the author himself, to know a little bit of the historical context that surrounds the reading that we'll be looking at, to have a sense of some of the literary features of this text. And of course, as always, we'll finish by framing a few big ideas that we'll use as a lens through which to view this text. One of the things that's kind of interesting about John Winthrop is the way that his story kind of parallels that of William Bradford, who we spent some time with when we read Of Plymouth Plantation. You'll see as we go over some of this information how their place in history and literature is somewhat similar. John Winthrop lived from 1588 to 1649, and he was born into a wealthy family of land-owning merchants. His father took a position at Cambridge University's Trinity College when John was very, very young. So from a very early age, little Johnny would have been exposed to some pretty complex ideas, and he would often sit in the room as his father would have these complex theological discussions with local clergymen and professors from the area. So it comes as no surprise then that John Winthrop would be a bit of an intellectual himself. He would go on to study law and work as a lawyer in London. Interestingly enough, though, John Winthrop viewed his vocation as a way to advance the kingdom of God, which is certainly something we can all aspire to consider when we think about our work as well. If you think back to what we talked about before reading Of Plymouth Plantation, you'll recall that King James I, when he came to power in the early 1600s, put a lot of pressure on anybody who was critical of the Church of England. He was succeeded by, or followed by, Charles I, who ended up marrying a Roman Catholic woman. So it's safe to assume that he continued the legacy of dealing pretty harshly with anybody who would be critical of the Church of England. John Winthrop was a Puritan. So while the Puritans were still trying to reform the Church of England, to purify the Church of England, if you will, by removing the influence of Catholicism, you can see how that might put these two groups together, the royalty being married into Roman Catholic tradition, and this group that is trying to reform the Church. The separatists were busy dipping out. You know, they left. And that's where William Bradford comes into this story because, if you remember, he and his buddies formed the Plymouth Colony at the end of 1620. So they're off doing their own thing because they've assumed that the Church of England is beyond all hope of repair. And that, of course, leaves the Puritans who are still committed to trying to fix things, trying to avoid the inevitable breakup between the Protestants and the Catholics in the Church of England, at least for a little while longer. King Charles I dissolves Parliament, which means he increases his power, increases his ability to deal harshly with anybody who would criticize what he considers to be a very important part of the Church of England. And so he's cracking down on the Puritans pretty hardcore. It's not that much longer after that, in April of 1630, where four ships leave England for Massachusetts Bay, and John Winthrop is on this ship. During that journey, he writes and delivers a sermon called A Model of Christian Charity. If you look at this map here, you can see the path that William Bradford and his group of separatists rolled into Massachusetts Bay and set up kind of at the south end of the bay and formed Plymouth Colony. Well, Winthrop and his boys roll in at about 1630, basically right next door, just on the northern end of Massachusetts Bay, and they're the ones who form Massachusetts Bay Colony. So by this point in time, John Winthrop has already been elected as governor of Massachusetts Bay Colony. In fact, 6 months before they even left to go to their colony, he had been elected to this position, and he serves from October of 1629 until May of 1634. So a pretty good chunk of time that he spends leading this group. it's going to be helpful for us to set this within our broader discussion of the different phases of colonization. Now, we've talked previously about the first phase, which is discovering, where wealthy nations fund expeditions to find and claim territory. Obviously, they would gather information, stake out a claim, and then return home, hoping that later they would be able to come in phase two, which is settling, and establish a more permanent settlement with the help of people who were much more sturdy and much more resourceful. Now, one of the main things that sets phase two apart from phase one that we haven't really touched on yet is the fact that in order for a settlement to become permanent, it's really, really critical that everyone work together. Unity is a key feature of phase two of colonization. Think of it this way. If I'm focused on the ground as I till the earth to quite literally produce sustenance for the community, it's really important that I know that my neighbor isn't going to sneak up behind me and club me over the head and take my stuff. Unity is a critical and key feature of phase two of colonization. And there are really only a couple of ways that you get everyone to consent to working together and living amongst one another peaceably. Often, the primary unifying ideal for a colony is the pursuit of money. If everyone's working together to make a profit, then everyone's happy. Other times, though, the primary unifying ideal is religion. And so far, both of the texts that we've looked at, Up Plymouth Plantation previously, and now A Model of Christian Charity, in both of those texts, we have examples of strict adherence to religious principles as a unifying feature within the colony. Either of those unifying ideals are ways that you can bind a community together to get them to work together in order to create habitable order out of chaos as they attempt to move beyond phase two and into a thriving permanent settlement. Let's take a look at a couple key literary features of A Model of Christian Charity. A Model of Christian Charity is a lay sermon, which is basically a sermon written by a lay person or a non-ordained person. So it's not your pastor that's speaking to you in this case, it's a regular person. And as a sermon, this is not necessarily literature in the traditional sense. It's not a narrative, it's not a story. However, it does use literary elements to move its ideas forward. And so we can call it literature. One of the main goals of this text is to outline a type of utopian society that Massachusetts Bay Colony will become. If you think about what a post-apocalyptic or dystopian text might look like, it's the opposite. This is aspirational. It is a goal that we're setting for ourselves to build the perfect utopian society where everybody works together and everybody is holy. And really part of the way they get to that utopian society is by emphasizing the pursuit of personal holiness as a means to form a stable community. And this is probably one of the earliest threads of individualism that we see woven into the narrative of America. We'll see it again, trust me. Put a pin in that one because individualism is a key feature of all of American literature. And then, of course, by the end of this text, we get a very famous quote, "For we must consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us." This is kind of the climactic moment of A Model of Christian Charity. And it's a literary allusion, meaning that it's a reference to another text, in this case, the Sermon on the Mount from the book of Matthew in the Bible. And during the Sermon on the Mount, while Jesus calls believers to be salt and light, he mentions this line. In Matthew 14, he says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden." And Jesus goes on in verse 16 to say, "Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." So it's a very much a biblical idea that you should attempt to be a good example, that you should glorify God, and thus the rest of the world will see the glory of God reflected through your works. Well, Winthrop recontextualizes this very biblical concept, and it becomes a foundational statement in something called American exceptionalism. American exceptionalism is the belief that America is uniquely virtuous, that America has a special mission to transform the world, and that America has a superior strength that, of course, will allow them to accomplish this mission. American politicians, really throughout all of history, have referred to America as a city on a hill. And as a believer, we might hear something that is vaguely reminiscent of the words of Jesus, kind of dribbling out of the mouths of politicians, and be tempted to believe that Jesus would actually endorse this political candidate or this political system. However, I want to be very, very clear with you. American exceptionalism is a form of idolatry. And it may even be an example of using God's name in vain, right? Where someone who has power says something in the name of God as a way to co-opt his authority and then do something that wasn't actually ordained by him. It is a very, very dangerous place for a person to exist. It may appear to be something like benign patriotism, harmless sort of speech, but it can be a major, major stumbling block for the believer. And we need to be very cautious about how we perceive our political allegiance, our idea of nationalism. So let's finish up with a few big ideas. And there are some big ideas here. The first of them is who in the church can have authority. John Winthrop was a lay person. He wasn't a minister. He wasn't someone who was elected to be a part of some structural church hierarchy. He was a regular guy. It also raises the question of the relationship between the kingdom of God and the kingdoms of men, America being one such kingdom. Can we in good conscience pledge allegiance to a kingdom of man? Does that allegiance supersede our citizenship in the kingdom of God? That's really an important question for us to consider as we navigate civic engagement. And the last big question that I want to look at is, what role do believers play in modeling the kingdom of God? If Jesus, on this legendary Sermon on the Mount, tells us to be salt and light, what does that mean? How do we embody or dramatize the kingdom of God here on earth while we wait for God to come and actually restore everything, to finish the work that he started on the cross? This week's reading is substantially shorter than last week's reading, so I expect you to pay very close attention to what's going on. Maybe even consider reading this text twice and really doing a close reading to figure out what is saying about the organization of a society and what the believer's role is in that whole thing. If you take the time to genuinely engage with this text, I think it can be extremely fruitful and something that may even be transformative for you as a young American getting ready to go out and participate in adult life, whatever that happens to look like. And of course, we'll get together and discuss the text very soon. Until next time, good luck, have fun, what a time to be alive.